There's two kinds of music for me. There's the first kind of music that I use to test my hi-fi system, that I play when I've changed a component or moved a loudspeaker into a new position or moved some furniture around. And it's the sort of music that will make me go, oh, wow, isn't this great? Now, the second kind of music is the music that, from the moment I hear it, it draws me in. It pulls me in more and more and more until I'm eventually at a point where nothing else matters. Everything else in the world has gone, and I'm totally, totally engrossed in the listening process. It pulls my emotions. And maybe after half an hour, when the piece is finished, I end up somehow enriched. My life is something more than it was at the beginning. And the great thing is that really exceptional music can do this time and time and time again. For some people, it would be works like Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon or Wish You Were Here. Or for rockers, it might be something like Led Zeppelin's Stairway to Heaven. For others, the classical genre, it might be something like Beethoven's Fifth with its da-da-da-da introduction, or Dark Side of the Moon's boom, 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 boom. The moment you hear that, you know that something's going to happen. It's going to build and it's going to grab you. Well, today I want to talk about a piece of music that is both these things. It's the emotional journey music, but it's also the music that just sounds great on a system. And it's written by a composer, Jean Sibelius, whom after I name my loudspeakers after. Because he is a composer that was able to express all the sounds of the symphony orchestra and stretch them into these beautiful constructions. And the piece I want to talk about is his Third Symphony. Now, before you switch everything off and think, oh, I'm not into classical music and all that, oh, please don't. I want you to think back at a time when you didn't know the piece of music that really emotionally turns you. Think of it now, the music that you would choose as the last piece of music you would like to hear on this planet before your life ends. There was a moment in your life when you didn't know it. When you discovered it, when at a certain point someone may have played it to you or you heard it at a concert or whatever, and at that moment you thought, wow, maybe it took you a while to get to like it, to get to know it. Maybe you didn't even like it at first and it grew on you. Well, I think even if you're not into orchestral music, Sibelius's Third Symphony can do this. And if you set aside 30 minutes of your life to listen to it one time right the way through with the phone switched off and everything out of your life so that you can just really focus on the music, I'm pretty sure that you'll end up in another place. Now, the great thing about classical music is, orchestral music, acoustic music, is that because it's written, because the score is completely laid out in such a way that the composer indicates exactly how he wants it played. Lots and lots of orchestras and conductors will pick it up and go, wow, I want to perform that. And just taking Sibelius's Third Symphony, which is by no means one of the big famous symphonies of all time, we're still listening to it today, which is remarkable in itself. But there are probably 100 different recordings of this symphony. Some conductors, like Paavo Berglund, have recorded it 4 times with 4 different orchestras. Simon Rattle's recorded it 2x that I know of. And I want to show you what's so special about this. Like that introduction to the Dark Side of the Moon, as I've said, where you've got that boom, 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 boom. Sibelius 3 opens in the same way. But before we get started, if you're watching this video on your smartphone or laptop computer, May I suggest that maybe to move into your listening room, or at least put a pair of good headphones on, because I'm going to play you some extracts from different recordings of this great piece of music. And I think to appreciate them fully, it is best if you are at least getting the best sound you can from a YouTube recording, of course. So let's get started. I'm going to show you the opening phrase, this double bass sequence with the cellos, played by Sir Simon Rattle with the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra. It's a classic recording. It is probably one of the top orchestras in the world. Let's just see how he tackles it, the pace and the balance between the double basses and the cellos. Now you can hear the cellos are there, and there's a sort of a rumbling in the background for the double basses. And there you see, he's lifting it all up. Now back down to this big low part. You get this sense that it's a very even sound. The tempo is exactly as it should be, allegro moderato. It's not fast. Means allegro means fast, but moderately fast. I think he's taking it at what you would consider to be exactly the right pace for that. On the other hand, I'd like to play to you the same piece by Vladimir Ashkenazy with the Philharmonia Orchestra. Now, this sound is much bigger, and you get the feeling that something is about to happen, something big. You'll get a sense of a build-up. Let's just hear that again. And listen to the difference in the sound, because here Ashkenazy is really driving the double basses way, way harder. And there's, well, let's just hear it. Here we go. Now it's a deep sound, almost no cellos, mostly double basses, punching. Listen. Really deep subharmonics going on here. But did you notice too, the pace here is quite fast. He's taking it, you know, if you're saying allegro moderato, he's just about getting away with that, I would say. But let's just give you some contrasts, the difference between one conductor and another. And I'm going to start with this one, with Colin Davis, the opening of his recording with the London Symphony Orchestra. This is amazing. Listen to this. Listen how slowly he's taking it. Boom. It's not allegro, is it? It's like a slow march with Granny. You know. If it's allegro, it's very moderato. Now that's very laid back, and that's a live recording with the London Symphony Orchestra. And he's chosen to take it at that pace, and that's, you know, that's his choice, he's interpreting it. But just to give you an example of how it could also be done, listen to Lauren Marzell here with the... the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra. He's rushing out of the box like a man possessed. Listen to the pace. There's not much moderato about this. If I was walking to this, I'd be running to catch up. Allegro presto, I would say. So Isn't that incredible? You've got the same piece of music, you've got the same opening notes on the score, where it's clearly shown. Now, in the score I've got here, it doesn't give us a speed indication, but we can see with the ligament closely with the cellos and the double basses, and they're marked both as piano. But so one conductor is going to make the cellos louder than the basses, and another one will do the opposite. Yet they're both marked the same. So this is what's so great about classical music. You find a piece of music you like, and then thanks to streaming, you don't have to buy all the CDs, although I've got at least 5 or 6 versions of this in my collection. You can just listen to the different ones and find and study the one that you really, really like. Now, it's quite interesting because there is a conductor. I'm just going to pop him up here and cue him up and pause him for a second. Yannick Nézet-Séguin. And I think he came more from the opera world, but he's conducting the Metropolitan Orchestra of Montreal here. And his introduction, he's really choosing to go for the cellos as his main theme. Just listen to this. The pace is sensible, but it's mostly cellos. There is double basses. But, and listen here. That's cellos. And he's taken a much lighter introduction. So, from our different conductors, then, I suppose we can summarize for this opening sequence that the Philharmonia Orchestra under Vladimir Ashkenazy is quite balanced, but he's got lots and lots of power in the bass, and it's great, great fun. But this one I haven't played you yet, and this is Osmo Vanska with the Minnesota Orchestra. Now listen to the opening of this. It's so quiet and subtle. It's very quiet. I'm turning it up quite loud compared to the others. And it sounds distant. And it sounds like you can hear the mist coming in across the lakes. Now, I like this recording. Osmo Vanska is a Finnish conductor, and this recording was recorded by a chap called Jens Braun. And I was talking to him this morning, actually, about his approach to the recording. Because what is interesting about Jens Braun is that he's recorded this symphony twice. And he's recorded it once with the Minnesota Orchestra with Osmo Vanska, but he's also recorded it, let me just pause him a second, with Santtu-Matias Ruvalli, also a Finnish conductor, with the Gothenburg Symphony Orchestra. It is once in Minnesota, recorded in Minnesota, and the other one time in Gothenburg. And it's interesting because he was telling me that the Gothenburg Symphony Orchestra had a fantastic hall to record in, so the string sound was lovely and warm. And also, that I didn't know this, that Santtu-Matias Ruvalli was a percussionist before he became a conductor, and Osmo Vanska was a clarinetist before he became a conductor. And the approach of the two is interesting because Osmo Vanska is at least 30 years older than Santu. So Santu's a much younger, more, should we say, more dynamic conductor. But the sound of the recording here is fantastic. Let's hear Santu's opening of the piece. Now it's quite quick, a lot of deep bass, but the cellos are clear. Thank you. that's a very confident opening start when you compare that with Osmo Vanska. Let's hear Osmo one more time, just to go back. But it does build. And that is, for me, what is fascinating between all the different recordings. And I don't want to say which one I prefer yet, because it's still early days. There's three movements to the symphony. And I think it's a good time now to move to the second movement, because in the second movement, the first movement builds and builds and builds. Well, I tell you what, no, I'm going to play you one more part of the first movement, because I think it's quite interesting. This is Vladimir Ashkenazy, and this time what I'm going to do, we're going to start with the introduction with these growling double basses, and there's even subsonic sound coming in this room for this recording. It's incredible how low those basses are going. And I'm going to let it play until it builds, because I want to show you the big brass crescendo. Here we go. Here we go. Building now, can't you? Like the beginning of Dark Side of the Moon, you know it's going somewhere. It's building. Listen to this as it builds. For me, that's just wonderful. But there's something about the recording here I want to point out. This is Decca, and typically they recorded their orchestras using a Decca tree, which is the technique that I use. You have a big pole, basically, with a T section on the top, and you have three strategic microphones sitting on top of the orchestra. And the great thing about an orchestra is that the sound of the violins and violas tends to lift up into the air. So by using this technique, you get a lovely balance across the orchestra. It's more or less what the conductor would hear standing on his rostrum, but the microphones are placed about another meter or two above his head. But the interesting about this recording is that the brass, when it came in there, you probably heard it, is quite bright and almost rasping. So if you've got tweeters which are already on the excitable side, shall we say, you might find this recording a little bit bright at times, and if you have a tone control, you might want to just tweak that treble down a little, or, you know, because it is a little bit bright, which is very unusual for Decca. And that makes me think that maybe Ashkenazy himself or some of the producer had a big influence there. Because compared to the other recordings, that isn't the case. Shall we just quickly hear that again with the Minnesota and let it build? I'm just going to take it from about a few seconds in this time. Here we go. It's going to build. You see, it's quieter. Vanska's more subtle. Lovely movement, rhythms and structures. There's no doubt about it. The Vanska version is much more spacious. It's like being on an ocean liner going across the sea. Unlike in other earlier forms of classical music, where you would have a clear melody on the top and the orchestra supporting it. So, bum pa pa bum pa pa bum pa pa, and a melody on top. Sibelius sometimes gives you that impression, but if you listen very closely, you will see that actually that isn't the case, that each instrument is the melody. And you're listening to the accompaniment, you think, you know what, that could also be the melody. And that's what makes it interesting and difficult at the same time for the conductors, because they have to decide where they're going to put the emphasis, and where they put the emphasis changes the whole piece altogether. And what's also extremely tricky is that the rhythms are very, very, very complex. And great conductors are able to play with those rhythms and really hold the orchestra together in a way that others are simply unable to do. And it's for that reason that I'm choosing these pieces and I'm playing to you very, very carefully. Now, the first movement it's about 10 minutes long, and it builds and builds and builds until you basically get to the end of it, and it will come to this quite big crescendo. And once that crescendo's happened, you would be feeling normally what's happening next. Let's just take this now towards the end and hear Santtu-Matias Ravalli's ending. Now, this is the ending of the first movement. You see, it's getting big, cathedral-like. Ending like an amen, coming but building. Here we go. And that takes us nicely to the end of the first movement. And again, Santtu-Matias is really, really showing his skills here. Did you notice the slight delay before the last men? Amen. And that phrasing, that ability to play with the timing, I'm sure is coming from his percussive background. He's got that orchestra completely under control. And by making those spaces, makes it extremely interesting to listen to. But I suggest that we come to what I call the beauty within this piece. The thing I was talking about earlier about where the emotionally it will suck you in. Well, if it doesn't happen in this movement, the second movement, which is Andantino con moto, which really means quasi allegretto, which means andantino, it's andante. It's not fast, it's sort of slow, but with movement. So what we're looking for is the subtlety of movement and it keeping flowing, if you like. And I have to say that Santtu-Matias Ravalli is excellent here, and the Gothenburg Symphony Orchestra are great. Let's just hear the beginning. Now the theme is coming with the flutes, you think. But but listen to the basses. This is fantastic melody, which again builds. But the melody will come completely into its own when the strings take over. Sibelius is a great composer for woodwind players and brass players because he gives them so much to do, but it makes it extremely difficult because they have to be perfectly in tune and they have to come in at exactly the same time, which is not easy. Here, this melody, and hear him where he drives it forward now. Listen to the strings. Playing a sort of accompanying role. Now the flutes are taking the little side images and the strings are taking over. Isn't that beautiful? And that is Santtu-Matias Ravalli with the Gothenburg Orchestra. But let's take the same conductor, same recording engineer, but the Minnesota Orchestra. So this is Jens Osmo recording on the same piece with a different orchestra with Osmo Vanska. Slower, slower. The old man, or older man, is taking it at his own time. But you see that Osmo is giving every instrument equal voice, so you hear all the colors and subtleties in the piece that you might miss if you didn't listen carefully to Santo's version. It's fascinating, isn't it, how you can take the same piece of music and change it so dramatically. Let's hear what our friend Ashkenazi does. Now Ashkenazi, we know he's got this big orchestral sound, lots of heavy bass, sort of the rock conductor of Sibelius maybe. You see, he's taking this quite quickly. But it's flowing nicely. So the con moto is definitely there, and it is quasi allegretto. It's almost, yeah, allegretto. Minuetto allegretto, if you think of that from Mozart. It's very, very beautiful what he's doing here. The whole second movement with Ashkenazi is basically, I think it's 9.5 minutes. Now, if we take Lorin Marzell, he only needs 8 minutes to do the whole second movement because he takes everything so fast, if you remember from the introduction. Listen to the pace of this. I would say this is a good allegretto. It's very pretty, but it doesn't give you as big a contrast between the movements. Maybe lovely to listen to whilst driving along. It's got something to it, but very, very quick. It's almost as if he's in a hurry to get home for his supper. Maybe I'm being a bit unfair there, but compared to Osmo Vanska, I think it's very interesting. Now, I want to also explain to you just a little bit about something I've noticed, and which is very typical about the comparing between different conductors. I'm going to play you four versions, four little snippets of the second movement to show you how differently conductors take a certain part. There's a part in the second movement where the timpani join in on that melody. It's towards the end. So we'll go first of all to my friend, I don't know him of course, but Yannick Nézet-Séguin. Here we go. Now, in a minute, you hear the tune. Now, there's going to be some timpani coming in a minute. Listen. Now, I know it's towards the end of the movement, and it's almost as if Yannick wants to wake everybody up with that boom, boom, boom. When I first heard that, I thought, what the hell is that? Because it's not at all what I would expect. I'll show you what Ashkenazi does with the same piece. Now, obviously, it's a full minute and a half earlier with Ashkenazi because he's taking it so much faster. Now, the same sequence as we had before, but here, listen. Here they come. Very subtle. They're there, you hear them, but they're not dominating the piece. Let's just see what Santtu does with this. Now, he takes the second movement much, much slower. So it's almost a full minute longer than the Ashkenazi. In fact, it's a minute and a half longer than the Ashkenazi. We're going to take a little bit earlier so you can see how it builds. Here we go. Don't hear the timpani at all there. They're there, but they're completely subtly done. And he's a percussionist, and you would think he would be more like Yannick going boom, 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 not a word of it. But the rhythms that he builds are just fabulous. And for that, I can highly, highly recommend this recording on Alpha. It's such a great recording. I asked Jens Braun which one he preferred, and he said, well, he did like the sound of the second one because the hall in Gothenburg is so fabulous to record in. But of course, Osmo Vanska is such a great conductor. So actually, I would have both of those recordings without any hesitation at all. But I'm going to sum up in a minute. Let's just go to the end movement, the last movement, which is marked moderato, allegro, ma non tanto. So don't go crazy. It's a fabulous piece because it will build and build like the first movement. But with this last movement, which is the shortest of them all, this is the movement where it really gives you the feeling that you're going somewhere. It's a bit like time in Dark Side of the Moon, that you suddenly realize when you're on this one that you're on this journey and you're going to a destination and there's nothing you can do about it. And it's very disjointed. Here you've got the orchestra with all little themes and tunes going on. The first time you hear it, it's a little bit complicated. But you will see that eventually all these pieces will combine and weld into a glorious whole. And Santtu-Matias does this very well. You hear the strings building here. And then he plays with the rhythms. Very, very subtly. Jens's recording is fabulous, to be honest with you. I mean, the orchestra is fabulous. The intonation is superb. I think we're getting to the stage now where there's so many great symphony orchestras out there. You can't just say, you know, Boston or the London Philharmonic or certainly the Berlin is an amazing orchestra. But there are just so many now that can do great, great performances. You can listen to Berglund's recording with the Bournemouth Symphony Orchestra. Excellent, recorded a long time ago. But this one for Alpha on the Gothenburg Symphony Orchestra with Santtu-Matias Ravalli is just wonderful. Now, I'm going to take you just to a little bit further into the last movement, because you'll hear this glorious hymn-like melody that Sibelius supplies us with. And it's just a wonderful thing. And see how Santtu copes with that. You might find that annoying when you hear that compared to other versions, because you see he's holding it back like bum, 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 and it's almost like you're hearing it as an echo across the lake. Now I'm just going to play to you Osmo Vanska in the similar part of the movement to show you the difference in the timing in the orchestra, and then you can see which one you prefer. Here he's absolutely on the beat all the time. No sense of playing with the phrasing at all. And although I think Santtu-Matias is very interesting, I do prefer Osmo Vanska's control over the orchestra here. Not the control, sorry, that's not the right word. The phrasing. That he sticks to the original score on that. Because I think it works. I don't think it needs to be changed. I think Santtu-Matias' version is great for a live performance where you want to shake things up a little bit, but it doesn't need too much. So I think now we will just go through to the end of the piece, so you can just hear the finale, and we'll stay with Osmo Vanska. Why not? It's such a great recording with the Minnesota Orchestra. And you can hear building, and there'll be these big ending, typical Sibelius building. With the sound of the Minnesota Orchestra fading away, we come to the end of Sibelius 3. Now, I hope you enjoyed this, and I hope it inspires you at least to give it a listen and to give it a try and to find the recording that you like the best. Now, of all the recordings there are, if I could only have one on a desert island, I think I would take Osmo Vanska's, because it's so controlled and it's just so well phrased, and you hear all the instruments of the orchestra. There's nothing really exaggerating about it. And I can always remember Santtu-Matias' version, and that would always be in my head if I wanted to exaggerate it. However, having said that, Vladimir Ashkenazi's version, I definitely would like to sneak that into my back pocket as well, because it's such a great version when you want to just celebrate everything that's great about Sibelius and the joys of life and the energy that it inspires. Let's just end this little video recording with Vladimir Ashkenazi, because it's such a glorious rendition, and we will take it up gradually. Here we come. Now, you listen to how he will start to build this, and compare that with what you heard with Vanska. Now you can hear the strings in the back going da 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 da. But it's building slower. So we can expect a big brass sound, because this is what he loves. Thank you very much for watching. Enjoy your music, and I'll see you in the next video.